we saw in the last unit was that if we started with a tridiagonal matrix A, and we computed some unitary matrix Q such that Q transpose times A was R, an upper triangular matrix, and if we then took that unitary matrix and applied it from the right to that upper triangular matrix, then we ended up again with a tridiagonal matrix, where here we use transpose instead of Hermitian transpose because we knew that our tridiagonal matrix was real valued. Okay? The next insight into how to make the QR algorithm more practical has to do with the fact that anytime the resulting matrix is tridiagonal, the unitary matrix Q is completely determined by its first column. All of the other ones are prescribed. Okay, and how this becomes important, well, we'll see in the next unit. Now, it turns out that A doesn't even need to be tridiagonal. If you're given any matrix A, and you have some unitary matrix Q such that Q transpose A times Q is equal to, well, not even a tridiagonal matrix, but its generalization, something called an upper Hessenberg matrix, where if the matrix is not symmetric, then you could have non-zeros above the first superdiagonal, even though you have zeros below the first subdiagonal. This is called an upper Hessenberg matrix. Okay? So anytime you have any matrix A, in this case real valued, a unitary matrix that in this case is also real valued and therefore we really should call an orthogonal matrix, then if Q transpose A times Q is equal to an upper Hessenberg matrix, or equivalently A times Q is equal to Q times B, where B is upper Hessenberg, then matrix B is completely determined by its first column. Once you know that first column, all of these other columns are prescribed, provided the subdiagonal elements of the upper Hessenberg matrix are non-zero. And actually, to get to uniqueness, we need to sort of arbitrarily say that they're all positive valued. Okay? Now, how does this work? If we know what Q is, then we can compute A times Q0 on this side. But notice that that must be equal to the first column of the matrix on the right. And the first column of the matrix on the right is equal to beta 0, 0 times Q0 plus beta 1, 0 times Q1. Okay, so these two must be equal. Now, A is known, Q0 is known, Q0 is known here. We know that Q0 is orthogonal to Q1. So just like when we came up with the algorithm for computing the Gram-Schmidt process, we say, oh, we can then compute beta 0, 0, by saying, let's look at Q0 transpose A Q0. That must be equal to beta 0, 0. So at this point, we've also uniquely determined beta 0, 0. And what that means is that this vector minus this vector must be equal to that vector. Where have we seen that before? We have a vector that we now know that is equal to a multiple of a vector of length 1. We encountered that when we talked about the Gram-Schmidt process. And what we saw there is that your beta 1, 0 can then be chosen to be the length of this vector. But actually, you know, it only needs to be plus or minus equal to that length. So if we force beta 1, 0 to be positive, then we know that Q1 is actually uniquely specified. At that point, we have uniquely specified Q0 and Q1. We know what this is, we know what this is, we know what that is, and we know what that is. And you can see where this is going. We can now, on the left, compute A times Q1 to be the next column. Here we can take this times that plus this times that plus this times that. Okay. We can then determine what these values are by pulling the same trick of hitting it on the left first by Q0 and then by Q1. And then if we choose beta 2,1 to be positive, then it's uniquely determined, as is Q2. And we keep going. So the important thing is, if we know the first column of Q, and we know that B is upper Hessenberg with non-zeros on the diagonal, or actually positive values if we want uniqueness, then Q is completely determined, as are all of the values of our matrix B. And this is now going to allow us to pull a very special trick when it comes to our QR algorithm. Let me just finish by pointing out that if A and B are symmetric, or rather, if A is known to be symmetric, then we know that B will be symmetric as well, and therefore, instead of getting an upper Hessenberg matrix, we will actually get a tridiagonal matrix.